Well, good evening. Welcome to Falls Baptist Church. Great to have you here tonight. Let's take our hymn books. We're going to begin by singing together 453, He Keeps Me Singing, here in the middle of the week. I don't know what you're facing, what you're going through, but through it all, we can sing when we're with Jesus. Let's stand together and sing 453, He Keeps Me Singing. Here together. We're at 453. He keeps me singing. Though sometimes he leads through waters deep and trials fall across the way, path seems rough and steep. See his footprints all the way. That's how we can sing when we can have our eyes on Jesus and what he is doing. Let's sing this four stand together as the last. Though sometimes he leads through waters deep.
Wonderful start singing tonight. Thank you for being here. And let me just say as we get into this service that the main focus of tonight is going to be to seek the Lord together, okay? And so even as we're singing right now, and as you'll hear a brief challenge from the Word of God in a few minutes, I trust that your heart tonight is going to be, Lord, would you meet with me and meet with this assembly right here and help us to genuinely come to your presence and experience your power to pray. We'll guide it specifically tonight. I trust that you've come prepared to meet with God tonight. And so that's why the worship time here that we've just had, as we start, we're going to continue to sing, is so important to free our hearts to truly be able to seek the Lord. So let's pray. Lord, would you work in our lives here tonight? And I pray that we would have hearts that are filled with praise and thanksgiving to you, no matter what trials we're going through. That last verse of that song is so true, that no matter what trials, no matter what things you put across our path, Lord, when we're looking to you, we see your footprints all the way, and that does keep us singing. And Lord, you're a faithful God, you're a good God, we thank you for that. Would you please just give us liberty tonight in the service and every aspect of it? Would you meet with us? We're looking to you tonight, Lord, to be the one that's in charge of this entire evening. And we'll give you glory for what you do in our midst, in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. The ushers are here with the prayer bulletin. If you need that tonight, please raise your hand as they turn and go to the back, and they'll be glad to get that to you. And in the prayer bulletin, there's multiple different requests or praises from different from our church family as well as from our evangelists. Both of them have reports, and so you can look at those and be encouraged and know how to pray. And also a report on the prison jail ministry. Praise God for some encouraging things there, but also a need for greater opportunities, breakthroughs there and for a year of God delivering and working. Obviously, the current church burdens are current and things to be praising God for, but also really to be seeking the Lord about. So let me encourage you to really ask God to use this prayer bulletin as a guide for you this week to pray. So thank you for all that you've done to input into it, and let's pray that God will work in our lives as we pray for one another.
Number 19 in your songbook, the songbook. We're going to look at number 19 here and sing that together. It's amazing how many songs and even texts in the scriptures relate the Christian life to the idea of a journey or being on the way, walking with Jesus. We see so many of those pictures used, and that really is the reality of there's nothing static about our Christian life. We're going somewhere, and that's certainly something we need to be cognizant of as we're walking through, again, step by step. Every step matters. What direction are we going? But in this song, Singing I Go, it talks about, as I'm walking on life's road, praising the Lord. Singing, and that gets, we can sing it. It's a nice thing. Oh, we sing when we come to church, but it's a very practical thing as well. I wonder how often in your life, as you're walking through life and you're faced with a decision or you're in a situation, how often is there a song that comes forth from your lips, a verbal praise to the Lord. It's amazing how in my own life, I find myself doing that frequently. And whenever I do, it lifts my spirit because it lifts my eyes to the one that I'm singing about. So this is a practical song in many ways. And I love this text. Let's sing together number 19, Singing I Go. Stand together as we sing.
The trusting
again for joining us tonight for the service. Our pastor is actually taking a few days of vacation. It's rare I come up here and tell you that. Probably a little too rare. he's the hardest working pastor I know in the country, and he is committed to his church family here. And God opened up an opportunity for my parents both to be able to go for a few days to a warmer climate. All right. And so they're having a good time. In fact, it's funny, they're on vacation, but guess who preached tonight where they're at? Pastor did. I think literally the reason I think the pastor there found out he was around was that there's a couple that is in the church that they were at tonight that years ago my mom had the privilege of reaching on a bus route there in Diners Grove, Illinois. And this family got saved, reached through that bus route, and it's quite a neat story. Many, many, many years ago, how God worked in their lives, and they still love the Lord. And So pastor sent me a text. He said, we're sitting by the Iletos tonight in church. And just it's a special blessing. So pastor is, I'm sure he's done preaching now. But be praying for them to have a good rest of the time. He will be here on Sunday. And looking forward to that Altai Sunday. And he'll be here preaching. And so definitely be here on Sunday and be looking to the Lord to work. So be praying they'll have a good, refreshing rest of the time. God will bless their time away. It's a brief time, just 5 days, 6 days, I guess. But it's been a good time already, and praise the Lord for that. And they've had already one especially very significant gospel divine appointment today. And that was encouraging to hear that from pastor as well. Let me say a few things here. First of all, Commitment Sunday was Sunday. And I want to say thank you so much for your involvement in that. I haven't heard anything about it yet when it comes to the involvement, but I'm grateful. I know many of you made decisions of faith. You said, I'm going to trust the Lord. If you have not yet done that, you need a commitment card. There still should be more at guest services. And let me encourage you, one of the things that has been bedrock for me, I think I said this last Wednesday night, but is when I made that decision, and I did again on Sunday, I wrote on that commitment card a specific commitment to the Lord. And I can tell you with a good conscience that in all the years that I have done that, which is over 20 years, I have never gone back a penny on that commitment. And God has taken care of every one of my needs. And I'm glad I set that marker right there so I can't fudge. Life gets a little tough. I pull back or move, You just keep trusting the Lord and let him be the one to take care of me. And that gives you such a confidence when you just know that you're following the Lord. So I'm encourage you, if you've not yet done that, it's good for you spiritually, and it'll help you. And then this coming Sunday is All Tithe Sunday. And so I trust that you will come ready to give and prepare to give on Sunday. And we'd love to have 100% church-wide participation. I've looked ahead. I don't believe we have a snowstorm conflict coming in quite a while. Should be a good day on Sunday to come. No conflicts that way. So I encourage you to be here. Of course, you can give in person. We have the online option as well, as many of you also take advantage of that. And let's just all participate and be a part of that offering. Let me just say, this coming Sunday also begins our Baptist College of Ministry Institute. And if you still need a card or the info about it, or maybe you misplaced it and you'd like to fill that card out tonight, get it in. Ushers, please come. This will be the last time we pass this out. But guys, if you come, please. And if you need one, do not be ashamed to raise your hand, okay? We want to hear from you tonight. So if you need a card or the info sheet, you misplaced it, please raise your hand as the ushers turn and go to the back. And you can turn that in even tonight in the offering. And we would love to hear from you on this. The BCMI is how we'll say it, Baptist College of Ministry Institute, is going to be a great way for you to continue every trimester. We're going to do it 3 times a year. 10 weeks each time. We're going to intersperse that time with other training opportunities and other things that we'll have going on, but we'll always list out those 10 weeks that we'll have each trimester. So the first trimester starts in January, and then we'll start it again later in May and then in September. And so just so you're aware of that, that's how it'll work. Each time you attend at least 70% of the classes, that you'll get a credit for that course that you were a part of, and we really love for everybody to be a part of it. I was very encouraged by the sign up, really was, but I know there's many more of you that probably just didn't get it in yet and can do that. Now, all of you who are members of our church, which is most of you in this room tonight, you did receive an email yesterday, and it does provide a link. And so if you don't have a card, haven't decided yet, please help us in the next day or two by letting us know what group you're going to be in. Honestly, you can come Sunday and go wherever, but it will help us at least to be close to knowing our room situation, which classes need which room. And so please help us with that. That would be great. And I actually still have my card here, and I hadn't checked it off yet, so I'll get mine in as well. So I'll follow through. But we'd love to have an entire church family again. As I said earlier at 6:30, pastor 31 years ago when he got us, led this church in small group ministry, the passion for 5 o'clock wasn't just another thing to add to the schedule. It was very purposeful ministry training, Bible training, wanted to strengthen their church to be effective ministers. Remember, Ephesians 4 talks about how when the church is built up and when the teachers in this church are able to teach the Word of God and the gifts are there and the members of a church family are embracing that and they're learning and they're growing, what that does is it strengthens the body so that within the body, people are not getting tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine. And so the Ephesians 4 passage really... This burden for BCMI, that 5 o'clock hour, formerly called FIT, that is the burden of it. And so please, I trust you'll understand that, and so many of you already have jumped on board, and we'd love to have a huge church participation this coming Sunday. Want to also mention this, that we are very encouraged by the response this year for the Victory Conference. And we do obviously have a Baptist College of Ministry 25th anniversary, and we'll have several alumni here from around the country, but it's far beyond that. There is some very significant things that God's doing in drawing different pastors here from all over the country. We have several from Canada coming, several from South America coming this year, already signed up. It is, as I look at it, I mean, it far surpasses where we were at this point last year. And so I'm encouraged personally as I see God at work and just stirring up men to come, and men and families. And so do be praying about that. Now, on Sunday, we're going to hand out to you all an information sheet that will let you know how you can be a help during the conference. And so many of you ladies serve so faithfully in the nurseries, and that is, you have no idea how helpful that is to the families that come. And maybe you do, if you're a mom, you do know. But let me encourage you on that to sign up for things like that. Our housing is especially in need this year already. And so if you can help us with that, you can have the joy of being able to be a part of being a blessing to somebody else. I know that when I've gone to conferences in other churches and they've opened up their homes and let me stay there, it's been a huge help and a blessing. So I know it saves, some pastors really come from very difficult financial situations, and you housing will save several hundred dollars, and that's very needed for their personal lives or their churches. So just be aware of that need, and if you can help us with that. And there's other ways that you can serve. Take note of that on Sunday. But this last Sunday, we gave you the flyer for it. We wanted you to get the burden for it and know the theme and so on. And we'll keep talking about it, praying about it, and building up toward the conference. So the conference is going to be 1 month from Sunday is really when we start, Sunday night. And, of course, that weekend is also going to be the 25th anniversary of our college highlight. And we'll talk to you about that. That's not yet listed in the bulletin, but that'll be a very special, unique Sunday as well. So that'll be a great time. I do want to say how encouraged I was by what God did in the parent team retreat. It was just a sweet time of God at work. And the session that happened on Sunday was also a blessing with Pastor and just hearing testimonies. So that was good. Also, now that we're through the commitment Sunday, we don't want to confuse people, but most of you understand how this works here. But a week from Sunday, after All Tithe Sunday, as we keep all tithing every Sunday, right, will be Faith Promise Sunday on the 11th of February. And we're excited about having Pastor Rick Savage come. He'll be a real blessing. He's from Jackson, Tennessee, and you'll be greatly blessed by his ministry. He's spoken here before. So I encourage you to be praying about what God would have you give even this year for missions. Good to see Brother Jeremy back. Welcome. Welcome back. And we heard great reports. And I'll connect with you soon about a way you can talk to the church about what God did in Cameroon. I kept most of it back because I want you to be able to tell it. All right. So, but they saw scores and scores of people saved and saw God work. So I'll let him tell you that. And we're excited about even just the investment our church has made in Cameroon is making a big difference. So, by the way, your financial investment makes a difference. It's worth it. And so I want to thank the Lord for that. And then just real quickly, this Saturday is the men's prayer meeting at 7 o'clock. And men, let me encourage you to remember that and to be there. And it's so important when the men of our church gather together to seek the Lord's face. And so if you can make that a priority this Saturday at 7 a.m., that would be a real, real blessing. So those are the main things. I wanted to reiterate some things. And then, almost forgot a big one. Candyland Hotspot, okay? We had as you saw on the email a week ago, we had an issue with our website. The way we set it up, we didn't do it correctly with the form. And so people were thinking they're registering and weren't. And then some people was messing up on them. So we got that fixed as quickly as possible. I appreciate those who jumped in and fixed that. But here's the thing. Because of that, it got a little bit of a slower start. We've actually had a really good surge of interest from our emails that have been sent out and so on. And I'm actually encouraged with what I'm seeing. But I would definitely say we got plenty of room for growth, and let's not, like I say with Bible school or any other outreach, let's not just assume people will come, but that God can, if all of us just invite, have just somebody come, just each one of us have one family touched through it, it'll be worth it. It'll be a very powerful impact too. So your neighborhood, think about kids. My kids have actually, we haven't yet done it, but there's several names that they've said of kids on our street that we need to invite even the next day or two. There's people that you live by that a simple invite could make all the difference for their soul. So let's not forget that. All right, well, I want to mention one prayer request. And you saw the prayer chain email today about Gene Bradford. That's Tina Yeager's father. It's still a similar situation in that he's very close. And Brother Yeager told me a moment ago that every time he gets a phone call from his wife, it feels like it's right there. You know, it's just if you've gone through that before, you understand what they're going through. So Brother Bradford's a dear man. Tina Yeager's got wonderful parents. And it's sad because just a few weeks ago, everything was normal, right? I mean, comparatively, he's an older gentleman, but what was really functioning normally, and then he got sick, and then things just turned quickly. And so they've had a quiet trial, a lot of back and forth. He's in Indiana, right? Northern Indiana. So just pray for Tina and the rest. And who is it, her sister's there, mom? Okay. She also has a brother who is a school administrator, a significant Christian school in the D.C. area in Virginia. And so appreciate their family and what God's done through them. The Bradfords are good people. So this is a hard, hard time. So just pray for God's presence to be there, his comfort, and that God would minister to, especially Mrs. Bradford, and then also to the children that are there. So don't forget them. He's still not with the Lord yet, as far as I know. And just be praying for God to just minister to them. All right, let's stand together, please. Ushers, come. And let's go ahead and take our offering tonight. And let's ask God to give us a good offering even this evening, and then victory on Sunday with All Tithes Sunday. Lord, thank you for the privilege of giving. Thank you for the privilege of being simply channels of your goodness to us and really your provision for us. Now, Lord, I pray that there would be victory in our assembly. Lord, I think of the remarkable generosity of this group right here. They have given really above and beyond over these past weeks and months. And thank you for the increase in giving that you've given to this church family. And Lord, I pray that you would help us, though, to remain faithful and to see the full needs met here in our general fund, in our building fund, especially as we've committed to that. And then, Lord, we also think about missions coming. Lord, help our church to be involved in not just the local opportunities that are important and very significant, but also to be part of what you're doing around the world. So I pray that even today's offering, and then especially this Sunday, that you would bless it in a very special way, and that we would all be fully yielded to what you want to do. And thank you for all that you've done for us. Would you please bless this offering now in Jesus' name. Amen.
hymn books, number 63 in your hymn books. 63, Take the Name of Jesus With You. We'll sing just the first and second stanzas of this together here tonight. Take the Name of Jesus With You. Let's stand together one more time as we sing.
Take your Bibles and turn to Psalm 86 here. Psalm 86 this evening. We're just going to briefly look at this. Another psalm that would fit the title of the series that Pastor started back in September on Wednesday nights when he's been focused on this, on the fact of behind the veil prayers of God's servants. And we started last week in Psalm 63, a look at some of David's prayers in the book of Psalms. And tonight, we're going to briefly look at this psalm. I want to spend most of our time tonight as an assembly seeking God's face together. But I would like to go ahead and read this together. This psalm could potentially have been written tied to also the moment there, that the whole trial that he was facing with Absalom. I'm not sure of that, but I was reading some different writings about this psalm, and that was one thing that was put down as a possibility. But in Psalm 86, I want to go ahead and just read it straight through together, and then I want to make some comments here, and then we'll get to prayer. Psalm 86 says, "Bow down thine ear, O Lord, hear me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my soul, for I am holy. O thou my God, save thy servant that trusteth in thee. Be merciful unto me, O Lord, for I cry unto thee daily. Rejoice the soul of thy servant, for unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. For thou, Lord, art good, and ready to forgive, and plenteous in mercy unto all them that call upon thee. Give ear, O Lord, unto my prayer, and attend to the voice of my supplications. In the day of my trouble I will call upon thee, for thou wilt answer me. Among the gods there is none like unto thee, O Lord, neither are there any works like unto thy works. All nations whom thou hast made shall come and worship before thee, O Lord, and shall glorify thy name. For thou art great, and dost wondrous things. Thou art God alone. Teach me thy way, O Lord, I will walk in thy truth. Unite my heart to fear thy name. I will praise thee, O Lord my God, with all my heart, and I will glorify thy name forevermore. For great is thy mercy toward me, and thou hast delivered my soul from the lowest hell. O God, the proud are risen against me, and the assemblies of violent men have sought after my soul and have not set thee before them. But thou, O Lord, art a God full of compassion and gracious, long-suffering and plenteous in mercy and truth. O turn unto me and have mercy upon me. Give thy strength unto thy servant, and save the son of thine handmaid. Show me a token for good, that they which hate me may see it and be ashamed. Because thou, Lord, hast hope in me and comforted me." Lord, I pray in these brief moments that we look at your word that you help me. I feel so weak and inadequate to even articulate what I believe you have here in this section, but I do pray for your enablement and your strength, and prepare our hearts to seek your face tonight, I pray, even through this challenge. In Jesus' name, amen. We see a few things here in this passage of Scripture. The first I see are some petitions that David gives. Notice what he says in verse 1. "Bow down thine ear, O Lord, hear me." Petition 1 I see is just, "Hear me, Lord." Also, he says again in verse 6, he says, "Give ear, O Lord, unto my prayer, and attend to the voice of my supplications." Now, what is the ground that he gives here? What's the foundation for why he feels like he can say to the Lord, "Hear me, bow thine ear to me, attend, listen, pay special attention to"? Well, this is what he says: "O Lord, hear me for what? For I am poor and needy." What does the Bible say in Matthew chapter 5? "Blessed are the poor in spirit." You know, it's when we feel like we're okay and we've got it together, we have this inner strength of ourselves and we have a sense of you know, well-being that's manufactured, that's because just intellectually you feel good, or you just feel good about your relationship with God in a human confidence. But we need to all remember what David felt here: "Lord, I am poor and needy." In fact, God tells us in the moments of our greatest weakness, that's when we can experience God the most. So there's a sense of David himself recognizing his need. He says, "Please, Lord, bow down thine ear, Lord." Why? "For I am poor and needy." But also look at another petition he makes. Look at verse 2. "Preserve my soul, for I am holy. O thou my God, save thy servant," or "deliver thy servant that trusteth in thee." He's saying, "Protect me." Not only hear me, but he's saying, "Protect me." Now, why can he say, "Protect me"? Well, look what he says: "For I am holy." What is this? He's set apart to God. Here's David saying, "Lord, preserve me, protect me, guard me, keep me, for I am set apart to you, O thou my God. Deliver me, save thy servant that trusteth in thee." And then we find in verse 3, "Be merciful unto me, O Lord, for I cry unto thee daily." Petition 3, "Show mercy, God." Why? "Because you know I'm looking to you." God, this is nothing about anything meritorious, but Lord, every day I'm looking to you, I'm crying out to you. And Lord, just, I don't deserve anything, but just in your mercy, would you please be merciful to me? And then verse 4, "Rejoice the soul of thy servant, for unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul." Restore my joy is the petition. Lord, help me. Why? "Lord, I have a strong desire." The idea of "I do lift up my soul" is the idea of having a very strong desire for God. "Lord, I have a strong desire for you. I am pursuing you. I want you, Lord. Please, as I pursue you, would you rejoice my soul? Would you give me joy in my heart?" You know, friend, let me just tell you right now that it's very easy in the pressures and the difficulties of life to find ourselves not having the joy of the Lord. But God's joy will come to those who stay with a face that's set toward him and say, "God, would you restore unto me the joy of my salvation?" By the way, that's verse I just quoted there, and says from Psalm 51, when David was truly getting his heart right with the Lord. Listen, when your heart's free with God, when you deal with unbelief, when you deal with the things that are causing you to question God's character, you know one thing he does? He floods your soul with joy. A few days ago, I've told a few groups this just because it's been real to me. But a few days ago, God had to get a hold of this guy Monday night. He dealt with me in a very strong way about how I had been letting life circumstances affect my spirit and my attitude toward God. I had moments of victory. I got encouraged, but then I'd face reality again, and I would get discouraged. And then I started having a pity party. And Monday was one of those days that, like, everything that could weird could go wrong kind of was just going wrong. Set off here and there and everywhere. I'm thinking, and I really got to the point, I'm like, really? And then I had the privilege of being asked by pastor to speak to the ladies face to face. And then the lesson I was supposed to do was triumphing in trials. You know, there's something very good for a preacher to have to face the reality of what he's about ready to have to give. And God knew in my heart that I needed a moment of just reckoning with him. I just remember Monday night, I just said, "God, I'm releasing these things that I'm burdened about to you." And I just said, "God, I'm putting myself as a living sacrifice again." By the way, it's not a one-time thing. It's a daily. I die daily, right? And it was one of those moments that my wife and I were praying together, and I wept. I said, "God, I need your help." But I'm going to tell you what, after I released that to God, since from that point till now, except for a few moments that I've allowed myself to get into flesh, I have had the joy of the Lord like I haven't had in quite a long time. You know what happens when you just pursue God? And you say, "God, I need you. I'm poor. I'm needy. God, I can't do it without you. I'm looking to you, Lord. I want your life. I want your presence. I want your power in my life." Guess what happens? He fills you with joy when you surrender things to him. If you're struggling tonight with trusting God and having the joy of the Lord, I'm telling you, friend, you're holding back something from the Lord. It may be sin when it comes to something you're not letting go. It may be just the sinful choice of an unbelieving heart. But then we find David now coming out with some praise to the Lord. Look at verse 5. For thou, Lord, art good and forgiving, ready to forgive, and plenteous in mercy unto all that call upon thee. So he's petitioning the Lord. He's saying, Lord, hear me, protect me, show mercy, restore my joy. Lord, help me with this. And then as God's working in his life, as he's crying out to God, he's getting his eyes focused on God. He says, oh, look, Lord, you're good. You are always ready to forgive, and you are plenteous in mercy unto all them that call upon thee. And then in verse 6, he gave what I referred to already, another petition. Now, Lord, again, give ear unto my prayer. And then in verse 7, it's interesting, he says this, in the day of trouble, I will call upon thee, for thou wilt answer me. What do we find here in his praise? He is saying, God, I know that you will answer me. I'm guaranteed that you're not going to let me go. You're going to answer me. Now, I want you to think about this for just a minute. He started out just pouring his heart out to God. God knew where he was at. He was pouring his heart out to God, and as God's working in his life, and his faith is increasing, he's lifting his eyes upward. He's beginning to praise the Lord for his character, for who he is. He's then able to say in verse 7, Lord, in the day of trouble, and David had a lot of trouble in his life, and if this is in the moment of Absalom, I don't have confidence of saying that, but if it is, if this is the context, he was in a day of trouble. And he says, in the day of my trouble, I will call upon thee. And what's he saying? Lord, you will answer me. By the way, you don't get that confidence from just, okay, that's who God is, he's going to answer me. No, as you seek the Lord and as you spend time with him, you get a spiritual confidence that cannot be explained humanly. That's what God does. And then we find this in verse 8. Among the gods there is none like unto thee, O Lord. Neither are there any works like unto thy works. All nations whom thou hast made shall come and worship before thee, O Lord, and shall glorify thy name. He's saying, look, you're incomparable. There is no God like you. There are no works of anyone else or any other God out there like your works. Verse 10, he says, for thou art great and dost wondrous things. Thou art God alone. You are the one true God. When's the last time you had that kind of a praise to God? I hope it's today. But then it's interesting. He's petitioning the Lord. He's praising the Lord. And then there's another increased passion that comes. As we praise the Lord and we get our eyes on him, he begins to even work in our hearts about a greater level of growth and of spiritual work he wants to do. Look what verse 11 says. Teach me thy way, O Lord. I will walk in thy truth. Unite my heart to fear thy name. What do we find here? An increased passion. He says, teach me thy way. Did you get up this morning and say to God, teach me thy way, O Lord? I mean, not those words exactly, but was that your heart cry? Lord, today, no matter what you allow in my life, I just simply want you to teach me. Teach me. I'm a disciple of yours today. I'm a learner. I'm a follower. Teach me thy way. And then it says, I will walk in thy truth. That's a commitment he made to God. He says, Lord, teach me thy way. I'm committed to walking in thy truth. And then it says this, unite my heart to fear thy name. It's literally the idea of this. Fix all my affections to truly honor you for who you are. I don't want anything in my heart that's divided. I don't want any divided affection. My whole heart needs to be completely focused upon you and a heart that is not at all divided, but it's a heart that's comes from a single-minded perspective. And then it's interesting. He says, I will praise thee, O Lord my God, with all my heart. I not only see an increased passion, but then now he has an increased praise. I think it gets to a little bit of a higher level here because he says, with all my heart. And I will glorify thy name, what? Forevermore. I hear a crescendo going on here, don't you? For great is thy mercy toward me, and thou hast delivered my soul from the lowest hell. Lord, you've protected me, even protected me from premature death. He could have faced all kinds of crazy things. He knew what God had protected him from. And then he says this, O God, the proud are risen against me, and the assemblies of violent men have sought after my soul and have not set thee before them. But thou, O Lord, art God, full of compassion and gracious, long-suffering and plenteous of mercy. So what you have here is this. You have, as David's praising the Lord, he gives a dramatic contrast. What's the contrast? He says in verse 14, he says, there's those who have risen against me. These people are violent. They're vicious. And by the way, when you serve the Lord and you walk with him, you're going to face some violent and vicious people out there. That's just the way it goes. People that are trying to do what they can to destroy you, destroy the work of God. It happens all, don't be, you know, it doesn't surprise me when we have major outreach endeavors, all of a sudden we get just hate letters, hate emails here about you folks being out in the community. And just sometimes really just, it's almost satanic, it's devilish in the level sometimes. And you go, wow, okay. And here David was facing that in a very real way. And he says, look, and even look, and notice what he says, and they have not set thee before them. These people are godless people. They're godless men. But thou, O Lord. Now, by the way, what do we find ourselves doing when we face that kind of opposition? What do we find ourselves focusing on? That, don't we? See, so David states the obvious. He states what's going on. And then he turns his eyes and he says, but thou, O Lord, art a God full of compassion. Okay, so he's saying, God, you're not like these violent men. That's not you, God. By the way, when people have that kind of spirit and they're angry and they want to do hurt, believers do this too. There's no God in that at all. Don't get intimidated by Christians that are angry. There's no God in that. You can't be intimidated by that at all. But thou, O Lord, art God, full of compassion and gracious, long-suffering and plenteous in mercy and truth. And then his final request, his final petition is this. O turn unto me and have mercy upon me. Give thy strength unto thy servant and save the son of thine handmaid. O Lord, I'm your servant. he's very humble here in his approach. He's not looking at himself in any big way. He's saying, God, I'm your servant. I'm the son of your handmaid. O Lord, just turn unto me. By the way, you know, turn unto me is the idea of show your face. Turn your face to me. God, I want your presence. I want the reality of your blessing in my life. I want you. God, turn unto me, have mercy. And then look what it says in verse 17. Show me a token for good, that they which hate me may see it and be ashamed. Now notice, show me is the idea of make for me. It's God who's the one that makes for us tokens for good. When we're walking with the Lord and we're allowing him to draw us closer to him through difficult moments, and there's times that we're seeking God and we need help and direction, there are times that God in his mercy gives us tokens for good, and he makes them for us. God has done that for this assembly a few times. I won't get into the stories, but I've literally been in the middle of a few that have been absolutely remarkable, breathtaking. Still to this moment, it has helped my faith so much. And the most dramatic one to me, in my memory, there's several, but in my memory, the one that I'm thinking of right now is the land when we're in the office seeking God, Lord, please provide. And then we say, Lord, our faith's weak, but we know you don't want us to have a plan B. Would you give us today a token for good, something to show us that you're in this? And God gave us a $50,000 gift that day. You think that helped our faith? Oh, yeah. Now, was it easy after that? Okay, whoo. Church matched it, 57,000. We have 107,000 toward the 425,000 goal. It's going to be an easy ride. God's in. It's going to be great. No, wasn't easy at all. That was a really interesting journey. But God supplied the need basically to the penny of what we needed when it came down to it. That was our token for good. And what happens when God makes that for us? Well, those that hate God and hate us will see it and be ashamed. They'll just see the reality of God. It's not anything about proving ourselves. Because here's what we're proving. That thou, Lord, has helped me. And you've comforted me. So friend tonight, can you say that your petitions to God are from a humble perspective of your need? And as you come to him, you're letting your heart get filled with praise. And then your passion's increasing. And the praise increases, and he has all your heart. There's nothing divided there. And ultimately, you're able to have the faith to, even at moments when you feel real weak, you're able to say, God, would you make for me a token for good? If you're able to do that, and you're able to pray that way, God will come through and he will show himself in a big way. So tonight I'm burdened that as a church family, we take time to seek the Lord's face. And I would like for us to do something a little bit unique, but I'm doing it because of Pastor's emphasis on Sunday. And that is, I'd like for us to take this prayer time, and I'm going to endeavor to ask the Spirit of God to give me wisdom in guiding this. But I'd like for us to corporately actually kind of have an approach like the first section, at least, of the hour with God together. So what I'd like for us to do in this first few moments is to take time to genuinely praise the Lord. The Lord put on my heart to have us as a church have the theme of praising God for the fact that he is faithful and trustworthy. So whatever angle God is working in your life about with that, or just truth or scriptures that you know that you would like to, that the Spirit of God would lead you to pray, please do that. And then just follow my direction after that. We'll take time to yield ourselves to the Spirit of God, to focus on the Holy or the Father, the Son, the Spirit, and let God work in our lives about any unbelief and sin that we've allowed in that has clouded our vision of him. And then battling the enemy and his tactics. By the way, Satan has lots of different tactics. And he sure loves to get it on the wrestling against flesh and blood point. And that's not where the battle's at. It's a spiritual battle. And then claiming the promises of God, and then as God leads us then to intercede for his power. One thing that we introduced to the leadership tonight in the adult division is that we're burdened to have a top five rekindling, basically a top five burden for classes, not your individual list, which I trust you have one that you're working on, but every Bible study having five people that they're zeroing in on prayer and fasting, praying that this could be a saved person or an unsaved, but that's not, they may be enrolled or a prospect, but they're not right now connected to our church other than we have their information, but they're not, they're either struggling spiritually majorly or they're just not here at all and they need to be saved. And we need to pray about that. Now, I'd love for God to give us some miracles over these next few weeks and months. That people will be in your Bible studies because you prayed and you sought the Lord's face. So we need to pray for God to really ignite us, our hearts that way, and that we'd be willing to sacrifice in prayer and fasting. Nothing that's going to move mountains comes without prayer and fasting. It doesn't. And then ending our time together, just giving God glory and praise, and as we have time, we'll maybe sing a little bit to the Lord tonight. So I'd like to focus it that way, and I'll guide to the next as I feel the Spirit of God moving us, and we'll just see how the Lord leads. Just a few quick instructions. This is a symphony of prayer. That means the Holy Spirit needs to be the one leading this time. So pray what he puts on your heart and then stop and let somebody else pray. And let me encourage you too. It's easy in an assembly like this. There are some that by personality are more bold to pray out. And so there can sometimes be a smaller group of people that enter in and praying. But can I ask all of you tonight, every single one of you to enter into the prayer meeting as if you're praying out loud, and be willing to open your mouth and pray as the Spirit of God would prompt you? We can't have all several hundred of you tonight pray at once. That's not going to happen. But there are multiple of you that could, if the Holy Spirit was leading in your heart, could pray out. And don't pray if God, don't. There's no human constraint here. Do not pray if the Spirit's not in it. That's called like the kibosh on a prayer meeting. Don't do that. But if God's moving in your heart and you sense it's from him, then pray what he puts on your heart, and then be done. And remember, we're not praying testimonies. If there's a testimony, then say it's a testimony and give it briefly. But let's not tonight pray the announcements or anything like that. Our audience is God. It's not each other. And let's keep that focus tonight. And so what I'd like for us to do as we start in prayer is to focus, first of all, on the faithfulness and trustworthiness of our God tonight. All right? Can you join me in that? And then I'll just guide us along in each step of the way. Most of you are familiar with this. And I love to see a real chorus tonight of God's people joining together in letting God work. So let's go to prayer at this time.